أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله عز وجل وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد إن شاء الله تعالى this seminar is about what every Muslim should know last seminar it was about matters of aqidah matters of belief and this one إن شاء الله تعالى will be about matters of fiqh, jurisprudence, and particularly in the matters of tahara and salah, purity, and salah prayers. But before we talk about what every Muslim should know in matters of tahara, which is a condition for the salah to be valid, we first need to talk about what is the importance of matters of fiqh. Fiqh, the word fiqh, linguistically, means al-fahm or understanding, right? And this is why Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he would title a chapter in his Sahih, Bab al-Fahm fi al-Ilm, the chapter of comprehensive or comprehension or understanding of al-Ilm or the knowledge. He used the word al-fahm. And then, under the title, he brought the hadith of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ Whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants good for, He would make him يُفَقِّهُ This is the verb of al-fiqh. He would make him have the fiqh of the deen. And the explanation of this, what is the meaning of يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ قَالَ ابْنُ حَجَرَ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى أَيْ يُفَهِّمْهُ Meaning, that means he would make him comprehend the religion. He would make him understand the religion in the proper way. And that's why also the ulama, when they explain this hadith, they say the opposite of it is true, which means whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want good for, He would not make him comprehend the religion. So it's a great ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the person to be able to comprehend the religion, to understand basically what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. Matters of aqidah are the belief, the foundation for anything. And then the matters of iman builds up on this, whether it's matters of belief or matters of actions. And when it comes to the action, the second pillar of Islam is about the salah. The first one is La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, comes under the matters of belief. Then when it comes to the physical action by different parts of the body, the first order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after the belief is to establish the salah. And the salah, there is no share of the deen if the person does not perform the salah. And the Prophet ﷺ said in the authentic hadith, العهد الذي بيننا وبينهم الصلاة فمن تركها فقد كفر. That the covenant between us and them is the salah. Whoever leaves it, abandons it, he had disbelieved. Since the salah is the first or the most important act of worship, then we need to know the ruling of it. The rulings of the salah, whether it's something that comes before the salah, conditions of the salah, like the wudu, like facing the qibla, things like that. And the rulings of the adhan, and the rulings of to make wudu, then that means we make wudu with what? Can we make wudu with a sauce or anything? Or it has to be water? What is the characteristics of the water? And so on. And the salah itself, its pillars and its recommended acts and so on. Because this is the most important act in our life after having the belief that there is no one worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the final messenger, is to perform and establish our salah. And the different matters of fiqh. Matters of fiqh are basically of two types. Fiqh al-ibadat and fiqh al-mu'amalat. The fiqh of the ibadah and the fiqh of the mu'amalat. The ibadat is the acts of worship. Al-mu'amalat is the transactions. And it basically covers the whole entire life of the Muslim. So what is the fiqh of al-ibadat? It means how to perform the ibadah according to the specific manners and ways that is explained in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And that's why one of the principles that we should discuss inshaAllah ta'ala later is that when it comes to the ibadah, everything is forbidden except what's proven that it's permissible for us to do. And in matters of transaction, everything is permissible unless proven otherwise. So when it comes to matters of ibadah, salah, fasting, dhikr, these types of acts of worship, it is not permissible for anyone to make up anything or to make salah on his own or to make up a salah or whatever there is. Why? Because this has to come after the permission from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have to know first that this is part of the deen, and then we act according to what has been known from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Matters of transaction, buying and selling, everything is halal unless it's well known that this is haram. So, and this inshallah will be explained. So, knowing this, there are certain issues, there are principles that we need to first understand. So the importance of this is that the religion of a person can never be sound unless we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we say that there is no one worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is one thing of the belief. How can we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is the matters of fiqh. Knowing what is halal, what is haram, and all of that, it's part of saying la ilaha illallah. Part of what is constitutes la ilaha illallah is that the person will be obedient to Allah. How can he be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? By knowing what Allah wants from us, and then acting according to this knowledge. When it comes to how to perform the ibadah, and we talked about that last time, and we talked about the aqidah, which is the same manhaj, the same methodology. We worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based on what's in the Quran and what's the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and how it was practiced at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the early generations of Islam. The same methodology that all the ulama, the people of Ahlul Sunnah wa Jama'ah, they followed. So, how do we make the salah? What we see what's in the Quran, we see what's in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and how it was practiced at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the early generations of Islam. So then the basic principle is that we are followers. We do not invent things in matters of ibadah. We follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whether we know the wisdom behind what we do, whether we don't know the wisdom behind what we do, whether it feels good to do otherwise or it doesn't feel good, all of these things are all relevant. We're supposed to do what the Prophet ﷺ did, so it shows the importance of having his knowledge. So the goal of the Muslim is to get to know what the Prophet ﷺ, his way, his sunnah, and then the person will be left to do and to submit himself. So as a result of that, and not to take too much of the time, I need to be specific because this is also intended that we write things so that we try to memorize and study some of the concepts here. When it comes to matters of fiqh, at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what was the rulings then? The verses of the Quran are revealed. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaches the companions radiallahu anhu. They do what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells them. Matters of salah. Since we're talking about purity of salah, they would do whatever the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them to do. And he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِ يُصَلُّوا. Pray in the same manner that you saw me praying. So they would do the best they can in which they would imitate the way of the Prophet ﷺ. Someone had a question, someone would not have something that is understood, they would go to the Prophet ﷺ and ask him. And once the Prophet ﷺ gave them the answer, the matter is over. Right? And then they would submit themselves. After the Prophet ﷺ died, the religion of course was completed. from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet والسلام, the companions عنهم, took this knowledge and they spread it everywhere, and they will teach the people what they have learned from the Prophet. We know that in matters of the basic things in the religion, you would find there's two differences of opinion in most of the things that we do. Whether it matters of belief, matters of ibadah, alhamdulillah, we pray the salawat, the same number of raka'at. Anywhere you go all over the earth, people know what fajr is, and dhuhr, and asr, and maghrib, and isha. The same amount, numbers of raka'at, they pray in jama'ah, it's all the same. And this is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But there are some issues that there was differences of opinions even at the time of the companions radiallahu anhum in minor issues, in matters of ibadah, and even other matters, but since this is about matters of ibadah, so we need to learn how to deal with these differences, especially in the environment that we live in. What's the proper etiquette when it comes to differences of opinions? And these are crucial issues, because people, if they don't have the proper understanding of it, it can be a cause of so much disturbance and corruption and even fight and enmity and things like that among people, which is all major sins. They don't have the proper understanding of how to deal with these differences. So as a fact, it was present at the time of the companions of Allah, but each and every one of them, their goal was to follow the way of the Prophet. As a fact, not every single one of them was able to sit with the Prophet the whole time, hearing everything from the Prophet والسلام, and nobody claimed that. Even Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, the best of this whole ummah after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not know everything from the Prophet والسلام, and he, as it will come inshallah ta'ala, he had to ask some of the companions about certain issues, like the inheritance of al-jaddah, the grandmother. When the matter came into his time, at the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he did not know what's the ruling of the inheritance of the grandmother. He said, there's nothing in the book of Allah, and I do not know anything from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he said, I will ask the people. And when he heard two of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and a third one came, stating the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the grandmother would take 1/6, then he did and acted according to this ruling. This is Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And the same thing for Umar radiallahu anhu, as it will come inshallah ta'ala. But so the thing is, once they get to know the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they would submit themselves to it. And the more time passed, the more there was some differences of opinions in matters of ibadah and other matters. And this is what the Muslim, first we have to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to follow the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ulama warathatul anbiya," that the scholars are the inheritors of the prophets. And they did not inherit money or any wealth, they inherited this ilm, this knowledge, which is the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. The job of the alim is to direct the people to the way of the Prophet ﷺ, not to direct the people to anyone but Rasulullah ﷺ. So when it comes to the Muslims in general, this is something that is very important, they are either ulama or they are not ulama. So with the ulama, when it comes to the ulama, those who are scholars in the religion, they're supposed to follow the Prophet ﷺ in every small and major issue. Because they know, if a person is a alim, that means he knows the Quran, he knows the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, he do his best in trying to follow the truth in every single bit of matters of the religion. And if there's something that he does not know the ruling of it, is not capable of trying to find the proper understanding of it, he would ask those who are more knowledgeable than him, and he would imitate them maybe in that word, in that ruling. When it comes to the rest of the Muslims, their job is, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, that ask the people of knowledge if you do not know. And this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy for us. But both the ulama and the rest of the ummah, their goal is what? Is to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when the person, a simple person, asking a alim, asking a scholar, is asking the scholar wanting to know what is the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what is to the best of the capability of the alim, that this is the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the alim is the inheritor of the Prophet. So one thing that we need to make it very clear, that our attitude should be in matters of ibadah, in anything that we do, that my goal is that I want to make sure that this is to the best of my capability. This is the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If I have the means to achieve this and to find this, then I would act according to it. If I don't, meaning that the person lacking the knowledge, that means he has to ask the people of knowledge. So that brings the issue of, we know that there are madhahab. And the most famous madhahab are the four madhahab of the people of Ahl al-Sunnah, madhahab of Imam Abi Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam al-Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad. And these are four madhahab of the people of Ahl al-Sunnah. And they are both a'imma, and there were more actually madhahab, but these are the most famous ones that all the ummah had agreed upon about their virtuousness and righteousness, and their goal was all of them to follow the way of the Prophet ﷺ. They had differences in matters of some principles, and this is what is very crucial for us to understand. When we say the madhahab, what is the meaning of the madhahab? Madhahab is basically a scholar in the religion would follow, of course, the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. But if the matter is not clearly mentioned in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, what should he do to extract the ruling? And even when it comes to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, the Hadith, would he accept any authentic Hadith, or maybe if it's slightly weak, or the Hadith has to be famous among the people? So they had certain principles in which they would extract the ruling, the matter that might not be very clear to everyone. So that was madhahab, meaning if it's correct to say, there was certain opinions of Umar radiallahu anhu that was not the same as the opinions of other of the companions radiallahu anhu. The companions of the Umar, they had certain differences of opinions. There is the Abdullah ibn Abbas, he had his rulings, and Abdullah ibn Umar, and all of these things were, the goal was to follow the Prophet ﷺ, and some things, as it will come inshaAllah ta'ala, are not clear to others. So when we talk about what's the reasons behind the differences of opinions, so this is one topic. What is the reasons behind the differences of opinion? And another topic that is very important, which is the matter of taqleed. Is it permissible for the Muslim to do the taqleed? And we'll talk about what taqleed means. Some of these reasons that the ulama mentioned, and there's a famous booklet that talks about this, which is Shaykh Taymiyyah rahimahullah, which is called Raf' al-Malam 'ala A'immat al-A'lam, which means to relieve the blame from the a'imma, the famous a'imma of the Sunnah. Meaning these a'imma, they were not just basically people looking for followers to follow them. They did not isolate the people away from the truth, from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Their goal, all of them, was to follow the way of the Prophet ﷺ. So why then there is some differences of opinion in matters of fiqh and other matters? There are certain reasons for that. When he talked about these reasons, he said it's about three categories of excuses why there is differences of opinion. First, the first one, the alim or the imam, he would believe that the Prophet ﷺ did not say this, if he does not take a ruling, because simply the Prophet ﷺ to him, he did not say it, he did not make this ruling. The second thing is, he might know that there's a hadith regarding to the issue, but he might not believe that this was the meaning of it or the intent of the Prophet ﷺ of what he said. So differences in understanding the same saying of the Prophet ﷺ. And number three, he might believe that the ruling has been abrogated. And the nasikh wal mansukh is something that is very important for anyone to study if he wants to pursue the path of knowledge. So these basically the different or the many excuses that are mentioned based on these three main reasons, that the person or the imam would not believe that the Prophet ﷺ said it, meaning the hadith is not authenticated to him. The second reason is that they had differences in understanding the same saying of the Prophet ﷺ. Number three, that maybe the matter was abrogated. If we talk about it in detail, some details, and just briefly mention some of the reasons so that we have it and we maybe study them. First, maybe the hadith did not reach the imam, the alim, right? And as we said, nobody, this is consensus among all the women, no single person would claim that he has the comprehension of all the details and the small and the major issues of the sayings of the Prophet ﷺ and the whole detail of the deen, right? So nobody claimed that. So the first excuse is maybe he said what he said because the hadith didn't reach him, that the matter was not clear to him, which is part of the first reason that we said. And this is something that was never to any of the ummah of the Prophet ﷺ, and we mentioned the example of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, that he never left the Prophet ﷺ for a long period of time. And also Umar radiallahu anhu, the Prophet ﷺ, as he would say in the hadith, دخلت أنا وأبو بكر وعمر وخرجت أنا وأبو بكر وعمر. The hadith that I entered, me and Abu Bakr Umar, and we left, me and Abu Bakr Umar. Meaning, they constantly used to be with the Prophet ﷺ, very close to the Prophet ﷺ. And still, some of the rulings, they did not hear it from the Prophet ﷺ, so that's why Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu would have to ask some of the companions about the inheritance of the grandmother, for example. Also, Umar radiallahu anhu, he did not know certain things, and he would ask the companions radiallahu anhu, one of which, that we had mentioned before, sunnah to istighfar, taking the permission when a person enters. He did not know that it's to be done 3 times, and if the person does not respond, then he should leave, which is mentioned in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when one of the companions, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, he came to Umar radiallahu anhu, and he was trying to get the excuse or the permission to enter, he sought this permission 3 times, and there was nobody responded to him, he left. So when then Umar said to someone, go and see who's asking for permission, he did not find anyone outside. And then Abu Musa al-Ash'ari came later, and he told them, why did you do that? He said, I heard from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he mentioned to him the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that if any one of you seek permission to enter in a place 3 times, is not given the permission, he should leave. So Umar radiallahu anhu told him, you better bring a witness on this. So he brought 2 of the companions of Umar to a gathering, and he said, he did this, and all of them, they said, we heard it from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So then Umar radiallahu anhu would abide by this. So this is even Umar radiallahu anhu, and there are many actually examples, but just to make it brief, this is one of it, right? And also when it comes to Uthman radiallahu anhu and Ali radiallahu anhu, there are many examples in which it shows that the companions radiallahu anhu, they didn't know everything from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but once another would come and say, I heard this from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then the matter was over. And the matter was over. Why? Because this is the goal, is to find the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is the first reason. The second reason is that maybe the hadith did not reach him, but was not authenticated by the alim. He saw some reasons why the hadith might be not authentic. We know the Qur'an is saved from the beginning to the end of it. But when it comes to the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, in general, yes, it's saved. The sunnah is saved of the Prophet ﷺ. There is nothing missing in the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ that might get the person closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unless it's been saved for us. Right? But it's not saved like the Qur'an from one side of the book to the other. There are more effort was done, and this is by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that the ulama of this ummah are rewarded, so that people would strive and seek the rewards from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it's in its totality, it's saved. Nothing is missing from the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ that would increase the iman of the person or have an extra deed to be done and so on. So, but some of the hadith that the ulama might have differences of opinion with regarding to the authentication of it. So as a result, the alim would not give a verdict as a result of the hadith is being weak. Number 3, that he would believe that the hadith is weak by his own ijtihad, that others had opposite opinion to it. The second one is that the hadith is not authenticated, that not was established to him. The third one, there is differences of opinion, and he takes the opinion that the hadith is weak based on his own ijtihad. Number 4, some of them, they would make a condition for the hadith to be taken, that when it comes to the narrators of the hadith, they would be more strict than others when it comes to the narrators of the hadith, right? And the hadith, they have to refer it back to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then they would take the hadith as a result of that. Number 5, if the hadith had reached the alim and it's clear to him but he forgot it, can a alim do that? Yes, and it's something that is valid. Human beings forget. So they might forget something that already has they had mentioned it before or they know about it before. And this is something that he mentioned, the famous hadith that Umar radiallahu anhu was asked about a man being in state of janaba and he is traveling and he doesn't find water. So he told him not to pray till he finds the water. That means he should not make ta'amum. He should wait if he's traveling and there's no water to use for janaba, for the ghusl, for the shower, but he should wait till he finds the water. Then Ammar ibn Yasir radiallahu anhu told him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ama tazkur, O Amir al-Mu'mineen, the leader of the believers, don't you remember when me and you, we were with the camels, and we were in state of janaba, and I, Amma ana fatamadadtu kama tamadad ad-dab. And he said, and what I did is that he rolled over the sand like the camel would do or the animals would do, thinking that this is how to do the tayammum when there's no water. And he thought that since the shower is covering the whole body with water, so he thought that to do the same thing with tayammum, with dust that the person has to roll over the ground. So that's what he did, Ammar radiallahu anhu. And he said, and you did not make the salah. You waited till the water comes. So he said, and I mentioned that to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told me, إِنَّمَا يَكْفِيكَ هَكَذَا وَضَرَبَ بِيَدَيْهِ الْأَرْضِ وَمَسَحَ بِهِمَا وَجْهَهُ وَكَفَّيْهِ. And he said, and when I said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said, it was enough for you to hit the ground with both of your hands and to wipe your face and your hand. So Umar radiallahu anhu told him, اتق الله يا عمار, fear Allah wa عمار. So he said, if you wish, I will not tell you this. So this is something that Umar radiallahu anhu did not remember, that it happened, and Ammar ibn Yasir reminded him of it. Right? And if this is true about Umar radiallahu anhu, so of course those who came after Umar radiallahu anhu, they also can be subject to forgetting. So this is something, it's excuses to understand that the ulama, the scholar of the religion, if he makes a mistake, he gets one reward. If he gets the right verdict, he gets two rewards, as the Prophet said. It's not, of course, for us to judge and to say he's mistaken and this one is correct, but this is the saying of the ulama, for us to have the understanding that their goal was to follow the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also, the alim might get the hadith, but the meaning of the hadith, they might have differences of opinion of it, and there are many examples of this. And even from the verses of the Quran, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he mentioned about the iddah of the woman after divorce. What is the period of iddah in which her husband can take her back, in which she cannot be married unless the iddah is over? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran that in mutallaqat, they have the period of thalathat quru. The word quru was mentioned, which is the plural of quru. This quru linguistically can mean purity and can mean menses. So does the woman has to wait for three periods of purity, tahara, or three menses? Makes a difference, right? If it's three purity periods, the purity say it's 24 days of the month. So she has to wait 24 days, and another 24 days, and another 24 days, and then after that, the iddah is over, right? The other meaning is, of the quru, it can mean menses. So she wait till the menses come, and then after it's finished, then another one and a third one. And once the third one is over, then the iddah is over. Right? So there's differences here based on the linguistic meaning of the word qurba. And this issue had differences of opinions among the companions of the Allah. Till, and this is till in the difference of opinion among the four a'immah, right? And this is not the time to discuss it, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, because of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, there is one hadith that clearly mentioned that the qur in this case meaning the height, meaning the menses, so this is the correct opinion. But the issue is here, they can have different understanding to some of these rulings. Inshallah, we'll go into the question, inshallah, we'll keep it towards the end, I'll give some time, inshallah, at the end. And many other reasons that were mentioned. And this is one of the subjects that need to be dealt with details. But we have to understand that there are reasons behind it. And it's the mercy of Allah, again, that the matter is not in the major and the principal matters of our religion. It's something that is in matters of fiqh, and some matters of aqidah also. But it's something that does not make the person a deviant. And we have to talk, inshallah, we'll talk about the adab or the mannerism when it comes to the khilaf. But before that, some, or a very important topic. which is the issue of a taqlid. What does taqlid mean? Taqlid, it's an Arabic word that means a person is imitating. This is what it means, imitating someone. So the matter of taqlid in the deen means that a person would take a ruling in matters of the religion without having an evidence. Without having an evidence that this is the way. And it's even more, it needs more explanation than this. Again, we said that the people are ulama or the masses. The alim, and we have to define what is the alim, but the alim, the scholar in the religion, he goes by principles. And if the hadith is authentic, if the verse is clear to him, he would act according to this based on the principles that we have that he has. When it comes to the normal person, he asks, so when he asks the alim, what is the ruling of this? Does this break the wudu? Does this break the salah? And he asks the one that he trusts his knowledge and his religion. So the alim will tell him the ruling is this, your salah is not valid, you need to repeat the salah. So this person would take this answer and he would go and repeat his salah, right? Does this person that asked the question, he got to know the way of the Prophet ﷺ in detail and he made his own ijtihad and everything? No, he just took the sayings of the alim and he applied it. But not anyone, he did not ask a plumber or an engineer or anything, he asked a person of knowledge, that he trusts his knowledge in his religion, that this person is knowledgeable in the religion, he would tell me what the Prophet ﷺ would say if he's alive now. Of course, to the best of the capability of this alim, of course, nobody can claim that he has all the truth, but they all seek the truth. So this is enough for the common person. A higher level than this, and he has the right of that, is that the common person can ask in a very polite manner, and this is his right, but in a very nice way, very polite manner, he can ask the alim, can you please tell me the evidence behind this? Not to question the alim in such a way that, give me the evidence. Not like that, but he wants to know. So that he's of a higher level in which he would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It makes a big difference that he in his heart that this is the way of the Prophet ﷺ, or this is the best of his capability. And it's the right of that person to ask such a question. The alim doesn't have to give in the beginning the evidence, but if he is asked about it, then it is the right of the common person to get to know, because this is the goal of one's deen, is to know that this is the way of the Prophet ﷺ. And either the alim will tell him immediately, or he will tell him, I'll get back with you. And this is something that is can be done, and it's the right of the person, right? So, and this is a higher level. Not to question necessarily, but to ask whether the person will worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a clear way and clear evidence. And still that person is muqallid. He's still imitating, because when the alim tells him the evidence, it does not make much difference to him. Because if he goes and ask another alim, right, and the alim will tell him another opinion, and you give him another evidence, he might not be able to differentiate between the two evidences, right? So in that case, what should he do? He should take the opinion of the one that he trusts his knowledge and his religion more, and he would do that, and there's no harm on him, right? So in that case, he did the best he can. A higher level than that, if a person have the ability to differentiate between the sayings of the ulama, and this is level, does not come by wishful thinking or by a person have a PhD in engineering, he thinks that he can read very well the Arabic language and he can read the hadith and he can figure it out. It doesn't work this way. This is a fitna that we are living nowadays, and to some extent there are two extremes. There is the blind following in which the person would make someone other than the Prophet ﷺ is the one to be followed blindly, no matter what does he do, whether it's right or wrong, I don't really care. This is the way, and that's it, other than the Prophet ﷺ. That's not permissible for anyone to bring to the Ummah or to make to the Ummah an individual that people follow him like this blindly, except Rasulullah ﷺ. The other extreme, when people say, there are men and we are men, and we can just open the books and we can figure it out, and that becomes chaos, and people are become arrogant, and we know the deen when the people do not know anything. It's not an easy matter. So these are two extremes. The middle course, the way of the companions radiallahu anhum, is we need to have, at least our goal is to find the way of the Prophet ﷺ, and we do the best we can. If a person is reached the truth, mashallah, he's rewarded. If not, he's still rewarded, and he would ask the people of knowledge. So when it comes to the madahib, this is where the issue that should not be controversial, inshallah ta'ala, which is consensus among the ulama of this ummah. When it comes to the madahib, a person says, I am Hanafi or Maliki or Shafi'i or Hanbali. Right? For the alim, he can. But what does he mean when he says this? And you would read in the books, the alim so and so, and he al-Hanafi. For example, Abu al-Izz al-Hanafi, the one that has the Aqidah al-Tahawiyya. Right? This alim al-Shafi'i, al-Maliki, al-Hanbali. Right? What do they mean by this? They mean, in matters of principles, this is what he follows. Right? This is what it means if the alim is Hanafi or Maliki or Shafi'i. What is the meaning of principles? Principles meaning that the A'immah, they agreed upon that the first principle in matters of fiqh, in matters of the deen, how do we get the rulings? Is the Quran. And the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Not necessarily then the Sunnah, it's the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, because they're both revelations from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the ijma' or the consensus among the ulama. So, if the matter is mentioned in the Quran, and it's mentioned in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, then the matter is over. Right? There's no differences of opinion to talk about the salah as being obligation. It's done. The matter is clear and it has consensus among all the ulama. Right? And especially the consensus among the companions of the Allah. If there is an issue, a ruling, specific ruling, that the ayah in the Quran might mean more than one thing, or it's not there, that there's no hadith or a clear understanding of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, and there's no consensus among the ummah, that they had differences of opinion with regard to this issue. What should he do then? This is the principles come in place. So he studied the principles of Imam Abi Hanif, for example. So he would refer to the fourth principle, which is Al-Qiyas, analogy. Then they will get into the analogy of how to extract this ruling from some similar ruling that happened at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. Although there are other issues, like for example from the principles of Imam Abi Hanifa, that he won't accept any hadith like this unless the hadith was famous and known among the companions of the Allah. Also, when it comes to someone else taking another principle, like if someone is taking the principles of Imam Malik, if the matter is not mentioned in the Quran or the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, the evidence is not clear, it can mean more than one thing, there is no consensus about it, then he would take the actions of the people of Al-Madinah. The Malik would take the action of the people of Al-Madinah at his time, because these are the people that the Prophet ﷺ were among. So if it's something that is spread among them, that means this is the truth. Right? But with the condition of what? The matter is not clear in the Quran or in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and there's no consensus among the ulama about it. And of course, the matter that has consensus is far more than these issues that there's differences of opinions. Right? So we have to make sure that this is the right perspective. And if it's according to Imam al-Shafi'i, the principle will change. If it's according to Imam Ahmad, the principle, for example, will be taking a weaker hadith. And Imam Ahmad said that the weak hadith is better for me than taking an opinion. But the weak, he does not mean the hadith that is fabricated or someone liar said about the Prophet ﷺ. The weak, he meant by it al-Hasan, the one that Imam al-Hanifa won't take, for example. You know, a hadith that comes, one narrated a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, and it's not like the Sahih. It's something that is from the least levels of the Sahih, still Sahih. And still, the person can take this hadith. But he would say, I would take that better than taking the opinion or the analogy. So these are principles, right? So the alim, when he says that he is this or that of a madhab, that means he's following these principles, right? So when he studied the madhab of an Imam Abu Hanifa, it doesn't mean that he's taking every opinion of an Imam Abu Hanifa. It doesn't mean, and that's why even in the madhab, and the same thing with other madhab, that's why in the madhab, you would find that there is difference between the opinions of the Imam of the madhab and what is famous among the scholars of the madhab. Two different things. You would find that the opinion of the Imam of the madhab is one thing, but the madhab is another issue. Why? Because the students of the Imam, it has been among them that the matter is known based on what? Based on the principles of the same Imam. Right? Like for example, Shaykh Sami rahimahullah, he's Hanbali. He follows the principles of Imam Ahmad. But he would say, في فقه المعاملات أصول مالك هي أعدى الأصول. But he says, but when it comes to transactions, the principles of Imam Malik is the best. So when it comes to transactions, he takes the principles of Imam Malik. This is not a common person, this is a scholar in the religion. Right? He takes the principles of Imam Malik. And he had a reason for that, he said, because he took his knowledge from the most knowledgeable people at that time, which is Sa'id ibn Musayyib, in matters of transaction. right? So, and in some issues, for example, in his fatwa, he would say that the ruling of this is such and such, and the opinion, for example, of Imam Malik is the most correct opinion because that what fits the principles of Imam Ahmad. You understand this? What it means? He's Hanbali, right? That means he's following the principles of Imam Ahmad. So he comes into a certain ruling, like the issue of reciting the Fatiha behind the Imam. We know that reciting the Fatiha behind the Imam for the Ma'mum has different opinion. Should the Ma'mum recite the Fatiha behind the Imam or not? Right? And this is one of the issues that has different opinion. We still did not talk about the etiquette. The etiquette is something else, inshallah. But here, a'ala, so that we have some understanding where the ulama is coming from. So what to do? Some people say there's no recitation for the Ma'mum. Ma'mum just sit and stand and listen. Some said that he has to recite in the silent and the jahri salah. Even if the Imam is reciting Quran, you still have to recite Surah Al-Fatiha. And the differences of opinions is because of what? Because of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. They all the hadith reached them. One, the hadith of that no salah without the Fatiha. So they say it's a general for the Ma'mum and the Imam. And some said, no, this is only for the Imam, and there's other hadith in which this is not the time for the details of it. But the point is, there's differences of opinion. Imam Malik rahimahullah, he said that for the silent salah, the Ma'mum has to recite. And if it's a jahri salah, recite it out loud. If there is time, he will recite. He has to recite. If there is no time, then he does not recite. Some mandatory for him to recite if it's a salah that recited loud. Right? And this opinion, Shaykh Samtamiya rahimahullah, he said that this is the most just opinion when we look at all the evidences from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that what fits more the principles of Imam Ahmad that he follows. Right? So this is a'alim that applied this methodology in his understanding. He's not just saying or taking the opinions of Imam Ahmad, period, like this, but he would still use the principles, and this is what the means of the alim being of a certain madhab. He follows the principle of the Imam, the principles of the Imam. And of course, most of the things that he would say would be according to the madhab. Most of it. But he might one time here or there, because he's a scholar, and we have to repeat this over and over again. Not for the common man, but for the scholars of the religion, if the matter is clear to him, and he believes that this is the way the Prophet ﷺ, is not permissible for him to imitate it, because he's a alim. So this is something that the ulama they did. For the masses of the people, whatever country they are from, and we usually did not have this as an issue, especially if among us came from different parts of the world, you have a matter, you ask the scholars in the country, the environment or the locality that you live in, the matter is over and people are doing the same thing like the scholars are doing. So it becomes the job of the ulama first. That the ulama, they have to have this attitude that they follow the truth and they follow the principles of the Imam, no problem. But once the hadith is clear, once the matter is clear to them, this is the verdict that they would give to the people, and the people would follow them. You come into an environment, people are coming from different parts of the world. So these people heard from this alim, these people heard from this alim, one madhab and the other. So what happens here? Then we need to understand that the principle here is that we're following the Prophet ﷺ. And you do the best of your capability. You ask the person of knowledge and he give you the verdict. Someone might say, well, we need to follow one madhab. This is for the ulama, yes. They follow the principles. But for the common person, how would he choose a madhab? On what basis he would choose a madhab? Either he would choose it based on his ethnic background. So if I'm coming from Egypt, the majority of the Egyptians or the madhab that has been well known is the Shafi'i madhab. That means I would go back to my ethnic background and I would follow the madhab of Imam Shafi'i. If a person from the Maghreb al-Arabi, Morocco and Algeria and everything, and Mauritania and so on, and Mali, Africa, most of Africa, madhab Imam Malik. So he will be sitting in America and I say, I will choose the madhab Imam Malik. On what basis did he think that Imam Malik is the madhab to be chosen? And if we came from that part of the world of someone born here in America, what should he do then? Is it based on his parents? Or based on what? Based on desires, or this madhab is easier? I like this madhab because in that issue, it made it easy for me. So I would follow this madhab. Someone else, no, I would follow this madhab. Based on what? Based on desires, based on things that is not anything to do with knowledge. Right? So in that case, what should the masses do? The masses has no madhab. The madhab of the masses is the madhab of the people of knowledge. Inshallah, after 15 minutes, we'll answer the questions, inshallah. So the madhab, this is a very important thing. So the madhab of the common person is the madhab of his scholar. When he was at a certain country, he did not have means to study the deen. So he asked the people of knowledge in his place, and they tell him that the matter is over. Right? He goes to another place. If that other place he does not find a scholar of the religion, and he has to call someone that is overseas because he trusts his knowledge, inshallah, good. And ask him, and he'll tell you the verdict. But for someone to say, well, I'm just going to stick to one madhab, he won't have a means to choose. But when this can be permissible, if the matter is confusing, and he's in such a way that he cannot ask, he does not find people of knowledge, he does not have means to find the verdict and things like that, and he has a book about one madhab, and he will open it, and he will see that the ruling in this madhab is such and such, then of course he has to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he will do that, but not based on his desires. Not based on his desires that this is easier, because this is a dangerous route. People, what they do is, some of them, they would say, well, let's see, we're facing an issue here. What is the difference of opinion? They have no knowledge. So they would see that the opinion of this madhab is such, this opinion of this madhab is such, and so on. So let's see, well, let's pick the easiest one. And the matter, since it has differences of opinion, that means they're all correct, and we're all good, and we can just pick the easiest. Is this something permissible? Consensus among all the ulama that this is basically desires, has nothing to do with the deen. This is not the deen of Islam. This is desires. If a person pick and choose, based on what easy, all of these things, and this is a big movement and a fitna that is happening, based because of ignorance. So this is something that is not permissible. So what should they do then? They should ask the people that have more knowledge. Should they pick the most difficult opinion? Of course not also, because also that would be based on desires. But they would pick the one that they ask a person. They would ask a person of knowledge. They trust their knowledge and his religion, and they would give them the verdict, and then the matter is over. And they don't go shop for fatawa to see what is easier. Right? This is not permissible. So, but this scholar that they call, does it have to be from one that madhab or the other? No. If he's a scholar, alim, big alim in the religion, and they ask him, and he give them the verdict, that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered them to do. And this is one of the things which is actually I wanted to give more time to it, but it's such a very important debate, basically, that Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he mentioned in his book of I'lam al-Muwaqqi'in. This is a famous book of Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah. He was talking to one of these people that would say, you have nothing but to blindly follow a person. Take one person and just follow him. Take one madhab and follow this madhab, and that's it. When you don't have, you're not following the principles again. You're just following the specific rulings when the person doesn't have knowledge. He based his decision based on anything other than the knowledge. And this is something that is, of course, not permissible. We start with this, but I would like to spend time on this because it sets the methodology and the proper way of understanding this matter. And again, wait till you talk about the etiquettes of differences of opinion, because it should not ever split the ummah, and we should separate between the differences of opinion in this matter, fiqh, and innovations in the religion. These are two different things. Innovation in the religion, no room for it. But when it comes to differences of opinion, it's something that is inevitable. It happened, it has to happen, but we need to know how to respect one another and live with one another in the proper way, and have just to have the proper attitude of how to figure it out. It's not difficult, it's not going to make the life of the Muslim difficult. How can I figure it out? No. So first, and bear with me inshallah with this. He said that يُقَلْ لِمَنْ قَالَ بِالتَّقْلِيمِ. It would be said to the one that says that we should just blindly follow, period, no matter what. He said, لِمَا قُلْتَ بِهِ وَخَلَفْتَ السَّلَفِ فِي ذَلِكَ فَإِنَّهُمْ لَمْ يُقَلِّدُونَ. The question is, why would you do that when the early generations of Islam did not take this matter that you're doing? Like, Umar radiallahu anhu did not imitate Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu on everything. Did not perform the taqleed on Abu Bakr, and he knows that Abu Bakr is better than him. Why didn't he say to the people, the way is the way of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, follow Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu on everything he says? The same thing of Uthman alayhi, the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, they did not choose Umar radiallahu anhu afterwards. Right? And even from the four A'imma, Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, why didn't he tell the people that you should all follow Imam al-Hanifa when he said that people are عيال on Abi Hanifa on matters of fiqh. Meaning, عيال is dependent, like a small child depends on his father. He said that people are dependent on Imam Abi Hanifa in matters of fiqh, matters of understanding. So why didn't he, rahimahullah, Imam Shafi'i said to the people, instead of having to have his own ijtihad and things and masail and so on, why didn't he say just for everybody should follow Imam Abi Hanifa? Imam Malik, he was a student of Imam Malik, right? And he was considered even one of the people of Imam Malik. So why didn't he tell the people then the matter is over at this point? And why the same thing with Imam Ahmad? Because this concept was never there. The concept was for them to follow the truth. The people at the time of the companions radiallahu anhu, from the tabi'in, born, did not see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He grew up and he has an issue. What does he do? Does he ask, I need the opinion of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu? And you find a group of people following Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, a group of people following Umar radiallahu anhu. It wasn't the case. Their goal was to find the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would say. So they would ask the knowledgeable people among the companions radiallahu anhu. Right? The companions had differences of opinion. And as a result, people might have the same thing too. But their goal is to follow the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the same thing at the time of the four a'imma. And their sayings is so famous that each one of them, he said that if the hadith is authentic, throw my opinion against the wall. Right? They will prevent and deprive the people and warn the people from blindly imitating them. Imam Malik rahimahullah, when the Khalifa told him, and imagine the Khalifa. And the Khalifa, when he orders something, that means everybody would submit. And he said to Imam Malik that he wants to force all of the Muslims to follow the madhab of Imam Malik. He would just have the muwatta and that's it, nothing else. To someone might think, well, this would make it easy. People won't have them differences of opinions and this opinion, that opinion. And this was presented to Imam Malik, right? He won't say that because he will be of a status. He might think of it that this is best for the religion. People will all have one opinion and that's it, so that there's no differences. He told them not to do that, not to force the people, and he said, let the people take from what I took from. Of course, he means the scholars of the religion, to take from the same sources that Allah had saved for us, which is the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they would forbid their people from blindly following them and having as if there are sects among the Muslims, right? And it reached such an ugly state in some time of age, in which you would go to the masjid and you would find four mihrabs. One like this, for those who followed Imam Abi Hanifa. Another one, for, and this was in Mecca, for those who followed Imam Shafi'i. They won't pray at the same time. They don't pray behind each other. Because in one opinion, that would negate the wudu. And another opinion does not need to negate the wudu. So if he believes that the wudu of the Imam is not valid, how can he pray behind him? And that same thing was asked to the Imam. For example, Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, when someone asked him about the Imam, bleeds in the Salah, from his nose or whatever. To Imam Ahmad, one of his narrations, that this would break the wudu. He has to go make wudu, not break the Salah, breaks the wudu, he has to go make wudu. So when the man asked Imam Ahmad, what do I do when I'm praying behind an Imam, and he, al-Ra'af, which is his nose is bleeding. So what did Imam Ahmad tell him? He did not tell him, you need to go repeat your Salah because the Imam broke his wudu. He said, would you pray behind Imam Malik? He said, yes. He said, Imam Malik has this opinion. There's a big difference between the rule of this and then the ethical feeling with this difference of opinion. Imam Malik comes and prays. Would people say, well, I won't pray behind Imam Malik because he says that this does not break the wudu? If he says that, he's a deviant, right? The same thing, he was asked about someone, Imam is making qunut in Fajr. Fajr Salah, according to the madhab of Imam Shafi'i, that the Imam is to make qunut, dua of al-qunut, every day in Fajr Salah, after coming up from the ruku' making dua of al-qunut, right? So he asked Imam Ahmad, also, what shall I do behind an Imam that is doing this? And if we check ourselves, imagine that your Imam in the Salah, after coming up from the ruku' from Fajr, start making dua of al-qunut. What would people do? According to some opinions, that invalidate the Salah. Salah is not valid, right? But what should a person do then in that case? Imam Ahmad said, if Imam Shafi'i leading the Salah, won't you pray behind him? He said, yes. He says, this is the opinion of Imam Shafi'i. It did not mean that Imam Ahmad said that all the opinions are correct. No. His opinion that this is not correct in such a way. His opinion was to be done only at times of the nawazah, at the times of a severe calamity happening. But it doesn't mean that it invalidates the Salah, because that Imam or that person, He's not innovating in the religion of Islam. He's taking an opinion, even if it's a weak opinion, to some, right? But he's not doing innovations in the religion of Islam, and we have to differentiate between the two. That's why it's very important to differentiate between weak opinions, to some, and innovations in religion. Innovations in the religion should not be tolerated. And when it comes to innovations in religion, you won't find any of the imams saying that this is a ruling in the deen, because it's innovation. But when it comes to weak of the opinion, it doesn't mean that we say everybody is correct. No, there is one correct and there is one not correct. The people of knowledge, they strive and they find the verdict to the best of their capability, and we should not imitate. The masses, they ask the people of knowledge, you're praying behind someone that is doing this or that, the salah is valid, and this is one of the etiquettes that we need to learn based on what we understand from the deen of Islam. So he asked him, why would you blindly follow? And the early generations of Islam did not do that, did not blindly follow. فَإِنْ قَالْ, if he says, قَلَّدْتُ لِأَنَّ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ لَا عِلَّ لِي بِتَأْوِيلِهِ وَسُنَّةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ لَمْ أَحْصِهَا وَالَّذِي قَلَّدْتُهُ قَدْ عَلِمَ ذَلِكَ فَقَلَّدْتُ مَنْ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ. He would say, I imitated him because the book of Allah, I have no knowledge of understanding the book of Allah, and I cannot comprehend the whole sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the one that I imitated him, he knows, so I imitated him, and that's what I'm supposed to do. And that's a valid point here, right? And I hope that if you're hearing this and you want to write these things, because it's very important, so that we remember these things later on. Then he says, قِيلَ لَهُ, then it should be said to him, أَمَّا الْعُلَمَاءُ إِذَا أَجْمَعُوا عَلَى شَيْءٍ مِنْ تَأْوِيلِ الْكِتَابِ أَوْ حِكَايَةٍ عَنْ سُنَّةِ رَسُولِهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَوْ اجْتَمَعَ رَأْيُهُمْ عَلَى شَيْءٍ فَهُوَ الْحَقُّ لَا شَكَّ فِيهِ. He says, if the ulama had consensus about an explanation of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they had consensus about a matter, and this is the truth, no doubt about it, right? And this is something that is clear. ولكن قد اختلفوا فيما قلدت فيه بعضهم دون بعض. He said, but they had differences of opinion in what you had imitated some of them and not the others. فما حجتك في تقليد بعضهم دون بعض وكلهم عالم. What is your hujja then? What is your evidence in imitating some of them and not the others when all of them are scholars? Why did you pick that scholar to imitate when they're all scholars? Why did you make based your decision? And he says, وَلَعَلَّ الَّذِي رَغِبْتَ عَنْ قَوْلِهِ أَعْلَمُ مِنَ الَّذِي ذَهَبْتَ إِلَى مَذْهَبِهِ. And he says, and maybe the one that you did not take his opinion has more knowledge than the one that you took his opinion. So as he said, if he says the other, the one that is doing the taqleed, قَلَّدْتُهُ لِأَنِّي أَعْلَمُ.